Boldwood presents A Deadly Affair, written by E.V. Hunter and read by Emma Powell. The moral right of the author has been asserted. This performance is owned by Boldwood. Chapter 1.
I thought the winter would never end.
Alexi Ellis leaned back in her chair and smiled as spring sunshine broke through a heavy bank of cloud, peppering the side of her upturned face with its warmth.
Easter's coming up, so don't hold your breath,
her oldest friend, Cheryl Hopgood, warned. The English weather seems to think it has a duty to rain on everyone's parade come bank holidays. Alexi waved a hand in casual dismissal of Cheryl's assertion. Not this year, she decreed firmly. It wouldn't dare. We've had a quiet 6 months since that fiasco over Halloween, and no lasting damage has been done to the hotel's reputation. We're overdue a break from drama, and that includes the weather. She was referring to Hopgood Hall, the boutique hotel in Lambourne in which she was an investor. The house had been in Cheryl's husband's family for decades, but had been on the point of going out of business at the same time as Alexi had lost her position as an investigative journalist on the Sunday Sentinel. She'd run off to Lambourne with her feral cat, Cosmo, to stay with Cheryl and Drew and lick her wounds. She hadn't reckoned on settling in the sticks, though. She was a city girl through and through, with a nose for a story, but had surprised herself by finding the peace she'd been unaware she was searching for here in the Valley of the Racehorse. Unfortunately, since her arrival, not one but four murders had occurred in this sleepy backwater where horses outnumbered people, and many locals now considered her to be a jinx. Some had gone so far as to try and drive her out of the village, and at her lowest ebb, Alexi had been at the point of leaving, afraid that local superstition would have an adverse effect upon her friend's business. She was no quitter, though, and hadn't been responsible for any of the killings, so she'd allowed Cheryl to talk her out of leaving. Besides, with the help of Jack Maddox, an ex-Met police inspector turned private eye, she'd managed to find the culprits in all four of the murders. She and Jack were now an item, and country life, she had good reason to know, definitely had its advantages. In any event, it most certainly hadn't proven to be the dreary existence she'd feared. Drew kept telling you that the publicity created by the murders and your fair reporting of the facts could only enhance the hotel's reputation, Cheryl pointed out, leaping from her chair to pick up Verity, her 18-month-old daughter, when she took a tumble on the grass. She'd been attempting to chase Cosmo. Alexi's cat was decidedly antisocial, but knew better than to harm a hair on the precious baby's head. Instead, he glanced at Verity through piercing green eyes, as though checking to make sure that she was unharmed, and then twitched his rigid tail before stalking off. He was, as always, pursued by Toby, Cheryl's terrier, who was half the cat's size but devoted to the taciturn feline. And you know my husband is always right about these things. Well, of course, he's a man, isn't he? They both laughed. Not that we would still have a hotel if it weren't for your investment and innovative ideas to enhance our reputation, Cheryl pointed out. Drew and I wouldn't have done anything half so daring left to our own devices. My innovative ideas, as you call them, almost finished you off, Alexi replied, shuddering. But let's not go there. The ladies fell momentarily silent, watching Cosmo's black tail swishing as he crept through the undergrowth, presumably on the hunt for rodents that didn't have the sense to get out of his way. Toby spoiled the party by charging after him with enthusiasm and a distinct lack of stealth. Well, anyway, we're full over Easter, regardless of the weather, and have an encouraging number of bookings coming in for the summer. Of course, half of them only want to meet His Highness, Cheryl said, nodding towards Cosmo. All the publicity over the murders has made him quite the celebrity. Don't tell him that. He's already quite insufferable enough. Cheryl laughed. I suppose one thing that Ratface did for you was to feature Cosmo in his Sunday rag and enhance his reputation, which worked in the hotel's favour, especially now that Cosmo has his own Instagram profile. He has more followers than either of us. He only did it to curry favour. Alexi folded her arms and huffed. any reference to Patrick Vaughan, the editor of the Sunday Sentinel, who'd been her significant other at the time the paper had downsized, still rankled. Patrick had known her position was under threat, but hadn't warned her, nor had he fought her corner. She knew that he regretted that stance now, having assumed that she would hide away in Lambourne, get bored, and then return to the paper to take up the demotion that was on offer. How little he understood her. He'd been a perpetual thorn in her side since then. But all communication between them had finally come to an end when he and Cassie, Jack's business partner, had joined forces in an effort to have Alexi ostracized in Lambourne. Patrick had hoped that her unpopularity would force her to return to what she knew best. Their plan had almost worked too, thanks in no small part to Polly Pearson, a local B&B owner and famous gossip who had led the campaign to drive Alexi away. What Alexi had done to set Polly against her remained a mystery. But all of that was now water under the bridge. The Sentinel no longer benefited from her insight. Its competitors, on the other hand, lapped up everything she submitted, which hopefully embarrassed Patrick and made him realise the error of his ways. "Well, anyway," Alexi said, smiling and tugging at one of Verity's pigtails when she tottered up to them and offered her a flower that she'd plucked without bothering to include the stem. "Thank you, darling. Is that for me?" "She's a budding conservationist," Gerald said, beaming with pride. "Might be a good idea to teach her about stems in that case." Cheryl adopted an expression of mock censure. "Rome wasn't built in a day." "I take your point. But as I was saying, everything's settled down now and no one is having the bad manners to get killed on our patch. So hopefully we can look forward to a calm and profitable summer." "I drink to that, or would." Cheryl's words trailed off, but she grinned as she placed a hand protectively over her stomach. "Cheryl?" Alexi eyed her friend with the dawning of awareness. "What is it that you're not telling me?" "Well," Cheryl's smile widened, "we didn't want to say anything until we knew everything was okay, but..." Alexi squealed, jumped up from her chair and threw her arms around Cheryl. "Verity is going to have a sibling. Wow, congratulations, when?" "Christmas." "That's fabulous," Alexi resumed her chair. "No wonder Drew has been grinning like the proverbial these past few weeks. I've been busy with the book," she added, referring to a commission that she'd accepted to write a collection of in-depth exposés about cases of abuse, corruption and violent crime in which the perpetrators had evaded justice. Stories that she'd written for the Sentinel, but which had not seen the light of publication because the paper's legal team weren't willing to risk being sued. An opportunity to lay out the facts and highlight the loopholes in the legal system pounced upon by expensive defence barristers was too good to resist. There was a lot to be said for going freelance, Alexi had long since discovered. "The first draft is finished, but never mind all that. Your news is much more important and I want to know everything." "Not much to tell, other than I feel sick as a dog every morning. So come on, give me more about the book. I want to know." "Well, I'm happy with it, and now my editor is doing his thing. Time will tell if the publishers have the courage of their convictions, no pun intended. I've given them what they asked for, and hopefully they won't be as lily-livered as the paper was. Besides, I don't think I've said anything libelous." She grinned. "Provocative, perhaps, but that's a different beast. Provocation equates to sound bites, which equates to sales. Anyway, I shall be on hand to be the best aunt in the world when your time comes. Is Drew hoping for a boy this time?" "He says he doesn't mind, but I think he secretly would prefer a son." Alexi nodded. "Might be best. He's so besotted with Verity that I can't see him having enough love to spare for another daughter."
"Hey, I'm a big guy."
Huge arms wrapped their way around the back of Alexi and Cheryl's necks. For a large man, Drew moved with surprising stealth and had obviously overheard their conversation.
"And I have more than enough love to satisfy all the women in my life."
Alexi jumped up again and hugged him. "Congratulations."
"Ah, so she's told you, not left you to guess. I suggested holding off for a bit longer, just until we're sure everything's definitely okay. But I knew she wouldn't be able to resist sharing."
"And why should she?" Alexi asked, watching Verity as she ran up to Drew and he crouched down to catch her between his large hands, swinging her in the air and making her giggle. "You've played your part. It's Cheryl's turn to enjoy herself." Drew pulled a disapproving face. "I hope you're not implying that she didn't enjoy making the brat." He waggled his brows at her. "It takes two, you know."
"So I've been told. Never been tempted to embrace motherhood myself. The mere thought of all that responsibility terrifies me."
"You'd never met the right man before Jack came along,"
Drew replied, taking the chair next to his wife and watching Verity as she tottered after Cosmo and Toby.
"We were just speculating upon a profitable summer for Hopgood Hall," Alexi remarked.
"And it will be too, thanks to you. Lots of conference jollies booked for the annex."
Drew paused to rub his chin.
"And organised tours of training yards, which was also your suggestion."
"While trainers always seem to be short of dosh, despite the outrageous fees they charge, so it made sense to ask a few of them if they wanted to participate."
"We tried it a few years back before the pandemic, and they all turned their noses up," Drew shrugged. "Seems they're now as broke as the rest of us and no longer quite so elitist."
Alexi smiled. "How the mighty have been brought back to earth."
"When's Jack back?" Drew asked. "He's been away on his latest assignment for ages. I've forgotten what he looks like."
"It's all done. He's reporting to his client in person today, clearing up some paperwork, and then he'll be home."
"To make babies?" Drew suggested, waggling his brows again.
Alexi laughed.
"We're not all set on procreation," she pointed out. "The world is quite overpopulated enough."
"Seems to me he's too busy to spare the time to make babies, even if you wanted to," Cheryl said. "We barely see him."
"Oh, he prioritizes," Alexi assured her friends.
Drew grinned. "I just bet he does."
"Anyway, he and Cassie have decided still to work together."
"After the way she tried to get you out of Jack's life?" Cheryl pulled an affronted face. "How will that work? The trust must be gone. And more to the point, how do you feel about it? The last time we broached the subject, you said they were considering their future. I just assumed that he'd either go out on his own or find someone else to take over Cassie's position."
"It's more complicated than that." Alexi waggled a hand from side to side. "Nowadays, a lot of investigation is done online. Jack hates that and prefers to be out and about, sticking his nose in and acting on instinct. Cassie, on the other hand, can make computers sing for her."
"Point taken.
Besides, they're equal partners. If they split, then they'd have to value the business somehow, and one would have to buy the other out. Not sure either of them can afford to do that. Anyway, it was me who persuaded him to think carefully and not to act in anger. Cassie is not my favourite person, but she was manipulated into doing what she did by the hand of a master."
"Patrick," Cheryl said, grimacing.
"Patrick," Alexi agreed.
"He picked up on Cassie's partiality for Jack and her resentment of me, and once he had, she'd have been putty in his hands. They've had a good heart-to-heart, and Jack is as sure as he can be that Cassie won't step out of line again. Patrick had convinced her that I would tire of life in the country and run back to London. Cassie believed it because she wanted to."
"She thought she was protecting Jack from getting his heart broken," Drew said. "I can see how she would have bought that, because I know just how convincing Patrick can be."
"Well, anyway, business is booming, and they're going to hire another investigator to take the load off Jack."
"Good news," Drew said, leaping from his chair and catching Verity moments before she took another tumble.
As though aware that he was being talked about, Jack chose that moment to wander into the gardens.
"Hard at work, I see."
Alexi's heart lifted at the sound of his voice. She turned slowly to smile at him, appreciating the sight of him in jeans and his signature leather jacket that had definitely seen better days. His hair was a little too long and flopped over eyes hidden behind dark glasses. He had absolutely no idea just how sexy he looked without putting any effort into it, and Alexi wondered, not for the first time, what she'd done to deserve him.
"Always," she replied, lifting her face to receive his kiss.
Jack dragged up another chair and placed it beside Alexi's.
"There are police cars all over the village with lights flashing and sirens sounding," he said. "Glad to see they weren't headed in this direction for once." He grimaced. "I did worry, just for a moment."
don't even joke about such things, Cheryl scolded. Alexi and I were just contemplating the murder-free summer that's in front of us.
Too right, Jack agreed, leaning back in his chair and crossing one foot casually over his opposite thigh.
The police are probably on the trail of horse thieves, Drew said. I hear a couple have gone missing from a trainer's yard.
I thought they were better protected than the country's gold reserves, Alexi said. Alarms, cameras, electronic gates, the works.
Where there's a will, Drew said, shrugging.
Aren't the horses chipped, like dogs are? Gerald asked. I mean, how could they be sold on?
Stallions could be used to do what they do best, and a decent mare with a track record could be used as a baby machine, I'm guessing, Jack replied.
No idea. I'm definitely off duty.
He linked his hands together behind his head.
And I'm taking a long overdue week off to give some attention to my girlfriend. Talking of baby machines, Drew said, grinning.
Drew, I am not the maternal type. How many more times? We don't all want little people running round causing mayhem, Alexi said, smiling in spite of herself.
Keep telling yourself that, Cheryl said.
Cheryl and Drew are expanding their family, Alexi told Jack. Verity will have a sibling come Christmas.
Congratulations!
Jack righted himself in his chair, stood up and shook Drew's hand, then gave Cheryl a hug and a kiss. Cosmo stalked up to Jack and pushed his head under his hand as though not wanting to be left out. Jack laughed as he made a fuss of him.
Do you fancy going away somewhere for a few days? Jack asked Alexi once the subject of the new arrival had been exhausted.
I was thinking the lakes. I'm sure they must have cat-friendly hotels up there.
There's cat-friendly and then there's Cosmo, Drew pointed out. He's not for the faint-hearted. You know what he's like if he takes against a person.
He's mellowing with age, Alexi said defensively, making them all smile. And yes, a few days away would be lovely. We've both got relatively clear desks at present, so the time is right.
Yep, and we have a new investigator, so that anything that comes in over the next week or so will be his problem.
Who did you go for in the end? Alexi asked, aware that there'd been a number of applicants for the position.
Danny Fisher.
Alexi nodded. I thought you would. Better the devil you know.
Precisely.
We worked together at the Met, Jack explained to Cheryl and Drew. He had my back when the press tried to stitch me up and the head honchos hung me out to dry. He's disillusioned himself with the direction the police service has taken and has opted for early retirement. But at 45, he's too young to sit about twiddling his fingers. He's not married anymore. Like a lot of serving officers, his marriage didn't survive the antisocial hours. His kids are grown and he's a free agent, happy to move to Newbury.
Does Cassie like him? Alexi asked.
She seems to.
Anyway, we're agreed that he fits the bill and so he starts on Monday.
Does he need temporary accommodation while he gets himself sorted? Cheryl asked. We can arrange something.
Thanks, Cheryl. Jack nodded at her. I'll mention it to him. Not sure what he's got sorted.
Probably hasn't even thought about it, Alexi said, rolling her eyes.
It will ease the tension between you and Cassie with someone else on the team, mate, Drew said. Amen to that, Jack replied with feeling.
A commotion had them all turning in the direction of the hotel's back door. A woman who Alexi recognised but had never expected to see setting foot on Hopgood Hall's property flew through the open door, waving her arms in the air, tears streaming down her face.
You have to help me!
Polly Pearson, Alexi's main detractor, cried.
I'm being accused of murder!
Chapter 2. Jack was the first to recover from the shock of Polly's arrival, to say nothing of her dramatic announcement, which explained the police presence he'd noticed as he'd driven through the village earlier. They were in the part of the garden reserved for the family, but a couple of the hotel's guests were strolling about in the formal gardens on the other side of the privacy hedge. Polly's arrival had drawn their attention, and sensing an unfolding drama, they'd instinctively wandered closer.
Let's talk in the kitchen, Jack said,
placing a hand on the small of Polly's back and steering her in that direction. He glanced at Alexi, nodded towards the lingering guests and could see that she'd caught on. He could also sense her resentment at Polly's intrusion. That was hardly surprising, given the way she'd bad-mouthed Alexi so openly. Jack had no idea whether he'd agree to help her and would hear her out before deciding. Polly was a tall, slim woman, and Jack estimated her to be in her mid-40s. With her tear-stained, ravaged face, she looked more like 60 at that precise moment. Her shoulder-length blonde hair showed signs of greying roots, and mascara followed a line of wrinkles down her cheeks. Once in the kitchen, into which Cosmo, always alert to a drama, had preceded them with Toby in his wake, Jack ushered Polly towards a chair at the scrubbed pine table. Cosmo stalked up to Polly, regarded her for a prolonged moment, twitched his rigid tail in a gesture of disapproval, and let out a warning hiss before retreating to Toby's basket and taking up the majority of the space. Toby wagged his stubby tail as he occupied the small corner that Cosmo graciously left for him. "Sit down before you fall down," Jack told Polly. Polly did so, snuffling into a handkerchief and dabbing at her eyes. Drew poured a healthy measure of the brandy he kept to hand for cooking purposes and passed it to Polly.
"Drink this for your nerves," he said, his voice neutral.
Like Jack, he was well aware of the angst that the spiteful woman's tongue had caused for Alexi, and was clearly also reserving judgment now that she'd had the nerve to run to them for help in her hour of need. She definitely didn't warrant the expensive brandy kept behind the hotel's bar in Drew's estimation, and Jack couldn't argue with that. Jack glanced at Alexi, who stood just inside the door with arms folded defensively across her chest, her expression set in stone. Jack offered her a questioning look. He would send Polly packing without hearing her out if Alexi gave him the nod. She clearly understood and shook her head, which didn't altogether surprise Jack. Alexi had a big heart, understood the meaning of compassion, and was undoubtedly curious to know who'd been murdered and why Polly appeared to be the main suspect. "Why did you come to us?" Alexi asked, her tone neutral, giving nothing away about her inner feelings. Polly slurped the brandy too quickly. It made her cough. Alexi remained silent until she recovered, but Jack knew she wouldn't allow the woman to evade a question that she must have been expecting, a question that would help to decide whether or not she and Jack would help Alexi's nemesis.
I didn't know where else to go," she eventually replied, sounding both pathetic and desperate.
"And you assumed we would help you because..." Polly had kept her gaze focused on Jack, but now finally turned to look at Alexi.
"I'm sorry," she said. "I've been a bitch."
"And then some," Alexi replied. "I have yet to figure out what it is I did to you to deserve your spite." Instead of responding, Polly returned her attention to Jack.
"You have no idea who I am, do you?"
"Nope," Jack replied without hesitation. "Should I?"
"I've had the P&B in Lambourne for 5 years.
She paused, took another sip of brandy and swallowed it more cautiously.
"Before that, I worked at Holby's."
"The headquarters of the countrywide logistics firm," Cheryl explained. "You see their trucks everywhere." Jack could see that Alexi had now caught on, as had he. "You worked with my ex-wife Grace, I take it," he said caustically. "And assumed I'd taken Jack away from her," Alexi added, shaking her head in disgust when the penny dropped.
"Why the hell would you think that? You know nothing about me or my relationship with Jack."
She threw up her hands.
"It's not that."
Polly spread her hands, attempting to explain the inexplicable.
"Grace and I were good friends. Surely you heard her mention my name?"
She again glanced at Jack. "I vaguely recall a mention of Polly, but I had no idea that person is you. I'm absolutely sure that we've never met."
"You were still in the force, always working whenever there was a company due."
There was accusation in her tone, which Jack thought remarkable, given that she required his help and that his domestic arrangements were none of her business anyway. "Not that it's any of your concern," he said in an acerbic tone.
but Grace and I were divorced long before I met Alexi.
You kept in touch with your friend, Alexi said, told her about Jack and me, and decided to badmouth me out of a sense of misguided loyalty.
Or did she ask you to do it?
Anyway, why should I help you now that you find yourself in the middle of a murder?
I'm sorry.
Polly bowed her head and tears dripped onto the table's surface.
Really, I am.
I just bet that you are, Alexi muttered.
Jack had never seen Alexi half so angry before. She was always more than ready to help anyone who genuinely needed it. But this woman's audacity had even taken his breath away, and he thought he'd seen everything.
Grace really regrets your breakup and was hoping you'd get back together once you left the force,
Polly said into the ensuing silence.
I'm aware of that, and she knows it will never happen.
Jack threw back his head and closed his eyes. Okay, Alexi pulled out a chair across from Polly. There's no point dragging all that up. Let's get back to your reason for coming to us and establish the facts. Tell us who died and why you're a suspect.
My partner, Jerry Dawlish. He didn't come to breakfast this morning, but that's nothing unusual. He's a driver for Holby's. That's where I originally met him when I still worked there. We kept in touch, and whenever his schedule brought him down this way, he'd stay with me. Our relationship grew from there.
Not so much a partner then, Drew said. More a friend with benefits.
Polly shrugged.
I suppose. Anyway, he got in late last night, probably driven for longer than he should have to keep up with his schedule, so I left him to sleep in. When he still didn't appear for lunch, though, I went to wake him. I knew he had to be on the road again later today, and that's...
She choked on a sob.
That's when I found him on our bed with a knife through his chest.
Dear God, Cheryl muttered.
The blood, there was blood everywhere, and the smell.
She started to cry again.
I'll never forget the smell.
Did you check to see if he was still alive? Jack prompted.
I did, even though it was obvious from his staring eyes that he wasn't. Then I called the police and that's all I know.
Who came?
A patrol car at first and then a whole circus. Forensics, detectives.
Can you remember the name of the senior detective? Alexi asked, glancing at Jack. They both wanted to know if it was D.I. Vickery. He was a personal friend of Jack's, had investigated the last three murders in Lambourne and was fair and methodical. Jack couldn't decide if he wanted him to be involved or not. If he wasn't, then it would be easier for him to walk away and leave Polly to her fate.
Vickery, Polly said. I saw him here that last time at Hopgood Hall when that man was killed. Do you know him?
Tell us what initial conclusions he drew, Jack said, avoiding giving a direct answer.
He asked if anyone else had access to our room. I told him I have three rooms taken right now. Our door to the street is never locked, and nor is the one to my personal rooms, so anyone could have got in there. D.I. Vickery didn't seem to take that on board. He asked a lot of questions, like, did anyone staying with me at present know Jerry or have any issues with him? He wanted to know if Jerry and I had fought, which unfortunately we had the night before. He was drunk and loud, and I suspect some of the guests would have heard him, which doesn't look good for me.
He drove his truck drunk, Alexi asked, disapproval radiating through her voice.
No, he'd parked up and been to the pub, I think.
Did they say how long he'd been dead? Jack asked.
Well, I told them he was alive and well when he got up at 7 this morning, but if they think I killed him, then they won't take my word for that, I suppose.
She dashed at fresh tears with the back of her hand.
Anyway, he was alive when I left the room, snoring loud enough to wake the dead, and I'll swear to that on a stack of Bibles. Perhaps some of my guests heard the snoring through the walls, she added,
sounding as though she was desperately clutching at straws. The police want to talk to you again, I imagine, Alexi said.
I have to go to the station at 11 tomorrow to be interviewed under caution. I'm terrified.
Do you have legal representation? Jack asked. She blinked at him.
Do I need it?
Jack shook his head, surprised by her stupidity, which he put down to shock. You'd be an idiot if you didn't have someone there to protect your interests.
But I'm innocent,
she wailed.
For all his faults, I loved Jerry. I thought we'd be together forever. I was sure he was building up to popping the question. Then we could have run the B&B together. I could have got rid of my other part-time staff and turned a proper profit. We talked about it.
I'll give someone a call. A friend who might be able to help you, Jack said, extracting his phone from his back pocket and pulling up Ben Avery's number. The gangly solicitor with a mop of unruly red hair was often underestimated because he always looked so scruffy, so unprofessional. But Jack knew that he possessed a fierce intelligence. More to the point, he'd helped to exonerate suspects in the last two murders that had taken place in Lanbourne when the odds had been heavily stacked against them. This is getting to be a habit, Ben said, taking Jack's call. He listened without interrupting as Jack explained the situation and agreed to meet Polly at the station at 11 the following morning. Tell her to say nothing until I get there and not to talk to anyone else about this, was Ben's parting advice before ending the call. Ben Avery will meet you at the station tomorrow, Jack told her. Don't say anything to anyone, especially not the police, unless he's there. Polly looked completely dazed but managed a feeble nod.
Who would I talk to?
All your friends in Lanbourne will want to know what happened, Alexi pointed out.
But they're my friends,
Polly wailed. You came to us for help and advice, and if you don't take it, then there's nothing we can do to help you. Jack's voice was harsh. If we decide to help, Alexi added. Polly glanced at her. She looked shocked and ready to argue her corner. Presumably, she then recalled just how vindictively she'd vilified Alexi's name when she'd been in a similar position to the one that Polly now found herself in, and closed her mouth again without speaking. Only Cosmo's occasional growls broke the uneasy silence.
Alexi, I'm sorry, Polly said, meeting Alexi's gaze and holding it.
Alexi let out a long breath. Apology accepted, she said. I understand now that you thought you were protecting your friend's interests, but it's worth bearing in mind that there are always two sides to every story. Polly lowered her head.
I hear you.
Jack and Alexi exchanged a glance. Alexi nodded, and Jack knew she was prepared to help Polly, just as he'd suspected she would be now that they'd cleared the air after a fashion. What malicious lies his ex-wife had been spreading to cause Polly to take Alexi in such extreme dislike was another matter entirely, and one that bothered Jack more than he was prepared to let on.
What happens now? Polly asked.
You could leave it to the police, Drew said,
clearly not nearly so ready to forgive and forget the harm that Polly had done to Alexi.
Polly shook her head. They think I did it and won't look too hard for anyone else. I could tell that from the look on that woman detective's face.
DC Hogan? Alexi asked.
That would be her. Polly wrinkled her nose. She looked at me like something she'd scraped off the bottom of her shoe.
Jack nodded, aware that Vickery was fairer than some coppers, but even so, at face value, this case did look pretty open and shut. If you want our help, you have to be completely transparent. Are we clear? Jack drilled her with a look. If you lie or hold anything back, then you're on your own. Polly nodded. Drew, with Verity still in his arms, nodded to Cheryl.
We'll leave you to it in that case, he said.
What do you need to know?
Polly asked when the door closed behind Drew, meeting Jack's gaze and holding it.
Everything. To start with, the victim, Jerry. How long have you known him?
7 or 8 years. Like I say, we met at Holby's. He was popular with everyone, the life and soul. A handsome brute all the ladies adored, but he was a man's man too, if that makes sense. Never seemed to fall out with anyone. He said bearing grudges was too much like hard work.
Jack nodded. Go on.
6 years ago, my mum died and left me an inheritance. I'd always wanted to be in the hospitality trade, and I love horses, so when the B&B came up for sale in Lanbourne at that precise time, it seemed like providence. My offer was accepted, but then I got cold feet. I mean, wanting to do something but not having any experience, leaving behind everything that was familiar. I wasn't sure I could do it. But Jerry talked me into it, said he loved a woman who knew her own mind, that he'd make a point of stopping by on his runs up north, and that kind of made up my mind for me. You're in love with him, Alexi suggested, her tone softening. Polly threw up her hands. Ridiculous as it sounds, but yes, I was. So why would I kill him?
Did he stop by often, and how long for? Jack asked. I don't recall seeing you about the town with him.
I'd see him once or twice a month, but never for more than a night or two. I started to think that he was playing me, that I wasn't the only one. I was a useful free place to stop when he broke his trips, if you like. That's what we were arguing about. I'd had enough and gave him an ultimatum. He either committed to me, gave up travelling the country and linking up with God knows who, and helped me run the B&B, or we were done.
What did he say?
He agreed. Said it was time we settled down.
Fresh tears dripped down her face.
So why would I kill the man I loved? A man who had agreed to give up everything for me.
If he did agree, Alexi pointed out, raising a hand to cut off Polly's protest. Sorry, but we only have your word for the fact that he did. The police might take a very different view. He'd been sponging off you for years, but when you demanded a commitment, he laughed in your face. Jack added,
No!
Polly half rose from her chair.
That isn't what happened. I thought you were on my side.
You will need to explain everything you just told us to Ben Avery before the police speak with you.
I can't tell the police the truth about our argument, Polly protested.
I would strongly advise against holding vital information back. Jack shot back at her. They weren't born yesterday. He paused. Besides, if you were shouting, then you were probably overheard. Where are your private rooms?
At the back on the ground floor. I have a bedroom, sitting room and bathroom.
And that's where the argument took place. Polly nodded. And your paying guests, where are their rooms?
Polly swallowed. Immediately above mine, she admitted.
So if you were yelling at each other, they would have heard you clearly.
Polly looked glum, but suddenly brightened considerably. We did argue, she said. I screeched at him like a fishwife. I'd had enough, you see. He'd left his phone in the sitting room, and when he was in the bathroom, it rang and a woman's name flashed up on the screen and, well, I lost it, which is what made me give him an ultimatum. I've been thinking about it for a long time. Grace encouraged me to force his hand.
Jack grimaced, well able to imagine his ex-wife doing precisely that. Go on, he said.
I demanded to know who this Melanie was, but he became evasive. His voice was loud because, like I've already said, he'd hit the whiskey before he got to me and carried on drinking once he arrived. Said he'd had a rough week, but looking back on it, I'd swear he had something playing on his mind. He was subdued, definitely not his normal self. However long he worked, and believe me, hobbies get their pound of flesh, he was always upbeat and positive.
There are rules about how long truck drivers can be behind the wheel, Alexi said. Polly blew air through her lips.
Are there?
Go on, Jack said. You were telling us about your argument.
Well, when I asked about Melanie, he basically told me to mind my own business. His voice was loud, but it was me who did the screaming. When he refused to tell me anything, that's when I lost it and started pummeling his chest with my fists. After all the meals I cooked for him, all the nights he'd spent beneath my roof for nothing, all the side benefits, all the socks I'd washed for him, all the occasions when he'd made excuses not to go out, well, I saw red.
Jerry sounded like a real piece of work, Jack decided, who had Polly just where he wanted her.
I started to think he was ashamed to be seen with me, had a secret life that he didn't want to risk or something. My imagination got the better of me, and that name on his phone changed everything. So I told him it was her or me. If he didn't give up the life of a truck driver and move it to help me with the business, then we were through, and I meant it. I think he must have realised that because he agreed.
She shared an earnest look between Jack and Alexi.
And that's a God's honest truth.
Okay, Jack said, raising a placating hand. Take a breath and let's look into things in greater detail. First things first, has Jerry ever been married?
Yes, but it ended in divorce 10 years ago. His ex, Pauline, is happily remarried. He sees her occasionally because they have 2 kids in common. They're teenagers and the family lives in Southampton. Jerry has always paid full child maintenance, above the going rate, in fact, and there have never been any issues that I'm aware of between him and his family.
What about close friends? Alexi asked. Polly lifted one shoulder.
He gets along with everyone, but he's driving 5 days a week. Doesn't make for close friendships.
In other words, Jack thought, she had no idea what else he got up to when he wasn't with her. What can you tell me about the guests you have staying? Jack asked. Are they regulars?
One couple are. Jane and Derek Grant have a half share in a horse here in the valley. Their trainer has an open day on Sunday, and they decided to come down a few days early. They just love being anywhere near the horses and watching them in training. They'd met Jerry several times and shared a few drinks with us. They're almost friends rather than paying guests.
And the others? Alexi asked.
Paul and Michelle Sears are first-timers, booked in for the weekend as well. Not sure why they're here early or what their purpose is. They didn't say. And I also have a single gent, James Alton. He's a newbie too. I think he's an ex-jockey and has something to do with a bookmaker. We often get scouts down here watching the horses on the gallops.
Jack nodded. And the police have spoken to them all, I assume.
And they told them that they'd heard us arguing, I imagine. Polly shrugged. Well, what else could they do?
What about local people? Alexi asked. You're a well-known figure about town with a lot of friends. Have you had a falling out with any of them?
Polly shook her head. No, but if I had, I don't think any of them would go to such extreme lengths to have the final word.
It did seem extreme, Jack accepted, but stranger things have been known to happen. If Jerry was half as attractive and as flirtatious as Polly had implied, then perhaps he'd tried it on with one of Polly's friends. And when he wouldn't commit to her? Well, if Polly was to be believed, then Jerry seemed capable of stirring extremes of passion and exciting jealousy, so anything was possible.
Did your close friends socialise with you and Jerry? He asked.
Yeah, sometimes, but always in our house or theirs. Like I say, Jerry wasn't big on being seen out, and I understand that, or thought I did.
I've seen you a lot with Linda Beauchamp. She runs the convenience store, Alexi said. She refused to serve me once, presumably because she was in your corner.
Sorry about that. I didn't know.
She's on her own, I think.
Yes, she and her husband split a few years back, and she's sworn off men as being more trouble than they're worth.
And Maggie Ambrose is the third member of your coven? Polly blinked, but Alexi's expression remained implacable.
Yes, Maggie runs the yoga studio. Very spiritual.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.